I'm going to talk to you about something very important today. And many places you won't hear this message because they don't think it's relevant. I think it's relevant. I think it's important. Very, very important. Because you need to be prepared for something that's coming up on this earth. While we're here, we need to extend the kingdom of God wherever we go. But we must remember that everything as we see it will change. Everything is going to change. Shortly, you're going to find things changing all over the world. In fact, it's changing right now. And we need to prepare for the end times. And I'm talking to you about the end times. And this time, I want to do it with the emphasis on the book of Revelation. How many of you read the book of Revelation? It gives you a lot of revelation. Actually, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It reveals to you who this Jesus is that we serve him. It shows you the power that Jesus possesses. It shows you what's going to unfold on this earth in a few years' time. I can't say whether it's 5 years or 50 years. But one thing I can tell you, as real as I'm standing here, what's written in God's word will happen. Yeah. It must happen. And we need to see that the crisis that the different governments of this world are facing is because we are reaching the end times. And we're reaching the fulfillment of prophecy. And I want you to turn with me to the book of Revelation. I'm going to read a verse there. And then I want you to go back to the book of Matthew. But let's start with the book of Revelation. Tell the person next to you, I'm glad you brought your Bible. Okay, if they didn't bring their Bible, just ask them to look in the front book. If they can ever see what's written. Verse 16. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead. And no one may buy or sell except one who has a mark on his of the name of the beast or the number of his name. So that mark could be either the name of the beast or the number of that beast. Here is wisdom. Let him who understands calculate the number of the beast and the number of a man is for a number of a man. His number is what? 666666. That's the world system. And that's what's going to happen in the near future. Now, this incident that I'm reading about is actually going to take place in the tribulation times that's going to come upon the earth. We think that we face problems and challenges, but what I want to say to you today is what's coming on the earth during the time of tribulation is going to be worse than we ever read about or we ever imagined. You know, in a world of uncertainty, one thing is certain. Bible prophecy is 100% accurate. And you can base your life on what God said will happen. We know that these things will happen, but we can't give you a date and a time because no man knows this. Jesus himself said, only the Father knows when this is going to happen. But we can see the signs of the times. We can see what's going on all over the world. We can see change in governments. We can see changes in the world system. Towards the end of 2008, the financial crisis started. That was because of what happened in America and what they were doing and mismanaging or don't know how to handle their finances. And what happened was they were giving loans to people that could never, ever repay that. And what happened was the banks started to crumble. And this affected Europe as well. And when it affects Europe, it also affects South Africa. Because South Africa is exporting goods to Europe. And if they don't buy the goods, we are impacted as well. So the whole world has become, as they say, a global village. And so the financial crisis we went through in 2009 is actually a start of what's going to happen. I'm not saying that the world is going to end tomorrow, but I'm saying that you need to be prepared that things will change. Things will change. One thing is guaranteed. Regardless of what happens around you, things will change. In the tribulation, Antichrist will be controlling this world and the world system. And that's when they won't be using finance. They will either have a tattoo or they will have a computer chip on the person that might be on the right hand or on the forehead. That is to identify the different nations of the world. What's going to happen is you're going to find governments are going to get together. We have a government that's getting together, and we have a Southern African bloc, which is called SADC. And all the nations in Southern Africa, we trade with each other, and there's cross-border trade. Now, this is happening all over the world. When this is happening, you need to wake up and see, why is this happening? What's the reason for it? The finances, as we know it in the world system, will collapse. I'm saying to you, we need to understand that when God says something in His Word, it's going to happen. There's going to be something that will come upon the earth. The other day I was reading Time magazine, and they said, can Mario save Europe and maybe the world? The world is looking for a savior, a financial savior that can come and save Europe. And after that, the world. Mario is the new guy that replaced the Italian prime minister there. I'm not sure of his surname. But there's a new prime minister in Italy. So they are looking to people to step up and have answers. And we, the church, that has the answer, what happens with us is we just keep quiet because we're ashamed to talk about this thing. Pastor David, I heard that Jesus was coming back again when I was in Sunday school. How can I preach that message? I say preach that message because that's the truth. Yes. He is coming back again. Amen. Jesus is coming back again. Amen. What He said in His Word must happen. Amen. Amen. You see, we need to understand what's coming, and when we forewarned, we forearmed, we know what's going to happen. So we don't get perturbed and really shaken up when these things start to unfold. They will start to unfold. According to the South American tribe, the Mayan people that studied astrology and really were quite involved in that, they predicted that 2012 will be the end of the world. Now, I'm not saying that 2012 is the end of the world. I still see some things need to be put in place in the world system and in Israel. But we are near the end. There was a movie made last year, I think, or the year before, called 2012. Tell the person next to you, hello, you're sitting in 2012. Actually, the movie was about a flood that would take over the earth. But the earth is not destroyed with the flood at the end times. Yeah. There was one flood that was during the time of Noah. God said, I'm not going to destroy the earth with the flood again. And you can guarantee that. There'll be tsunamis, there'll be floods in different places, but not destroying the whole world. For those of you that came with me to Jerusalem, you saw the Wailing Wall. Now the Wailing Wall is the Western Wall that was made up with part of the foundation of the original temple that was built there. First by King Solomon and then by Herod the Great. Those are two temples that were built on the same foundation, and the two temples were destroyed. There has to be a third temple that will be built in a similar place or in the same place, because what God prophesied through his servant in the book of Revelation, things are going to happen in Jerusalem that's going to affect and impact the world. Jesus said some things interesting. You know, the disciples also were interested. They asked Jesus a few questions and they wanted to know, when is this going to be? What's going to happen towards the end? Turn with me to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. You can keep your Bibles open there. That's where we're going to stay today. And Jesus went out from verse 1 and departed from the temple. And his disciples came to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, do you not see all these things? Surely I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. So Jesus prophesied that temple that the disciples are looking at and marveling at, because it was a marvelous building. It was a majestic building. Herod took about 26 years. This is Herod the Great. He took about 26 years to build that temple. And they were looking at it and marveling at it. And Jesus turned around and tells his disciples, I'm telling you that there's not going to be one stone here left standing upon the other. And the disciples must have looked at him in amazement. Said, wow, this thing has been standing here for 26 years. It's been built. And you're saying it's going to be destroyed. Actually, it happened. Say, God's word is true. It happened. Just like Jesus said. Around AD 70, the Roman army was fed up with the Jewish rebellion. And they sent in an army to go in there and destroy Jerusalem. And they destroyed the nation, especially the temple, because the temple was the main focus of this nation. And so they destroyed this temple utterly, pushing down every stone, taking it off. Just like Jesus said, it will be destroyed. So I want to remind you, church, Christian believer, I don't know what's your stand right now with the Lord, but I want to say to you something very important. Make sure your heart is right with God. Make sure your heart is right with God. When you are serving God, regardless of what's going on all around us and what people say, this one says that and that one says that, and many people have different interpretations of the Bible, but the Word of God will never change. Amen. Say, it'll never change. Amen. Say, heaven and earth will pass away, but the Word will never change. Things around us will change. Everything will change around us. But God's Word is constant. Constant. And so that temple was destroyed just like Jesus said, and once again, the Jewish nation was scattered all over the world. all over the world. From AD 70, there was no nation there. Nothing. There were some nomadic tribes that came and settled there and lived in the area. The early 1900s, it became a British protectorate. They looked after the place. And then in 1948, after the Second World War, some of you are very young here, you don't remember any war. But after the Second World, some of you don't even remember 1976. After the Second World War, the United Nations proclaimed the Jewish state of Israel. And in 1948, that state was established after lying vacant for hundreds of years. It was by the hand of God. That was the only way this could happen. Because of what Hitler did to the Jews in the Second World War. I think that's what motivated them to say, give these people a place that they can call their home. And in 1948, Israel became a nation. But still, there were people living there. The Palestinians were there. There were a lot of people living there. And so what they did, they took Jerusalem and they divided it into two. It was East Jerusalem and West Jerusalem. And of course, a lot of the nations around Israel was upset about this decision about 1948 and establishing Israel. So in 1967, everybody say 1967. There was a six-day war where Egypt, Syria, Jordan joined forces. They decided that they're going to wipe out Israel once and for all. And they attacked Israel from all sides. Something miraculous happened. In 6 days, everything was turned around. And from Egypt, Israel took the Sinai. From Syria, Israel took the Golan Heights. And from Jordan, they pushed them beyond the Jordan River, across the Dead Sea, to send them back. 6 days. What I'm saying to you is, when God says something, it's going to happen. Why am I bringing Israel into the picture? Because in end time prophecy, Jerusalem plays a very important part. In end time prophecy, you've got to watch what happens in the nation of Israel. Right now, the Prime Minister of Israel has just gone to America and spoken to the American president. Some people say he's asking for permission to attack Iran. I pray that there is no war in the Middle East. But unfortunately, there's going to be problems in that area. I want you to wake up and see what's going on around you. Don't just get so caught up in life. I think we Christians that are westernized are always busy doing something that it's not often that we stop and reflect on what's going on around us. One of the tragedies, in my understanding, between the church and the Jewish nation is that God has given them so many feasts to celebrate, to just stop and take account of their lives. And we, in the West, we're always going, going, going. And even on Sundays, you ask people, why are you not in church? I have to work, Pastor. Well, what can I say? You have to work, you have to work. But we don't even take time to stop and reflect on what's going on. Today, it's March 2012. Lord, what are you saying to me? I believe the message to you is, wake up, because we're near the end. And the theme verse that this church, Christian Teaching Center, has taken as their mission verse is Matthew 24:14. In the face of adversity, this gospel will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations. And then the end will come. That's what Jesus said, and that's what we say. The gospel must be preached to all the nations. And in the end times, God will raise you up to be somebody that will get involved in the mission of the gospel. We must support missionaries. We must support people that are preaching the gospel. We must stand behind them as a church. And we do. But I'd like to see us do a lot more. I'd like to see us do a lot more as a church. We must get behind the gospel. We must stand with the vision. There's no time for people to find faults in one another. It's time for us to hold hands and unite and say, let's stand with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. When we talk to people, the first thing we want to know is where you come from, what church you come from. We're trying to figure out what's their doctrine. Who told you that your doctrine is 100% perfect? It's not time for you to now to pick out the differences with people and say they are right or they are wrong and we are right. We must look for ways that unite us. And what unites us is our faith in Jesus Christ. Do you have faith in Jesus? I know we can't compromise the basics of the doctrine, but don't look for division. Look for things that unite you, because we've got to stand together. This is the way I understand the end times. Now, you may have it a little different in your mind. That's your decision. This is the way I see it. I see the church going forth and preaching the gospel in all the nations. The next major event I see happening with the church is what we call the rapture of the church, or the true believers in Jesus. Everybody say rapture. Rapture. It's happened in the Bible already a few times, but with individuals. It happened with Philip when he was preaching the gospel. He was caught up. Paul was caught up into the third heaven. And he saw things that he wasn't allowed to tell us. Not everything. Some of the things he could tell us. So, this event will take place all over the world, where suddenly millions of true believers will disappear. Taken out of the earth. That will be by the force of the Holy Spirit. What will happen is the Holy Spirit will suddenly, at some point when the Father says so, it will be, you take them out of the earth. Because the church is also the bride of Christ. The church is known as the bride of Christ. And so, if Jesus is the bridegroom, he takes out his bride from the situation of danger and trouble before it's about to hit the earth. So after that, well, after the church is gone, actually, the sad part of it is a lot more Christians are going to be saved in the tribulation than before the rapture. Some of them think that the pastor is telling them stories. Go home and read your Bible. Go home and read your Bible. But the unfortunate part of it is the people that get saved in the tribulation will have their necks chopped off. They will be killed for the gospel. It's nothing. You get some idiot that will burn a Quran in America. I don't know why they keep doing that. And then a pastor loses his life in Pakistan. Can't you see what's going on? You need to get prepared, because We are in the end times. We are in the end times. And if you don't receive Jesus and give your heart to Him while everything is easy, when the church is gone, it's not going to be easy. Because the period of grace closes when the church is out of here. Grace is linked up with the church, with the church age. This started on the day of Pentecost. It will finish at the rapture. We are still in the period of grace. But now, you need to make up your mind to serve the Lord 100%. Give your heart to Jesus. Because in the tribulation, Antichrist will control the world. And then, when he dishes out this, what a scripture that I read, the mark of the beast, those that don't accept it can't buy or sell. They can't trade. You can't be part of the economy. So what happens? You'll be hunted down and killed in the tribulation. That will last for a period of 7 years. I'll show you that in the book of Revelation. It's also in the book of Daniel. 7 years, the tribulation will be here on the earth. After that period is over, you know, that 7 years is going to be terrible. In fact, the scripture says, if Jesus doesn't come back, the world will annihilate itself. I think there was going to be a nuclear war. I'm convinced there's going to be a nuclear war in the tribulation. Because what actually happens is the rotation of the earth is changed during that time. You can't see the sun properly, you can't see the moon. The stars are shaken. What happens is 1/3 of your day is taken out. So you don't have 12 hours. In daylight, you have 9 hours, right? And then you have 9 hours of night. So your day is not 24 hours anymore. During the tribulation, it changes to 18 hours. Can you imagine what war is taking place on the earth? Where every island is shaken, everything is shaken to the core. Massive war on the planet. You don't want to be around during that time. I advise you to serve the Lord with all your heart right now. At the end of that 7 years, quickly, I've got to tell you so many things, but at the end of that 7 years, the second coming of Jesus Christ to the earth. Jesus comes back to the earth. Everybody say, Jesus will come back.
Jesus will come back.
And when he comes back, he restores some order here, gets some sanity back on the earth. There's still ordinary people living here. And Jesus brings some order to the earth while he brings peace. Wherever Jesus is, there's peace. So after the tribulation, can you remember this? If you can't remember this, get the tape. 1,000 years of peace on earth. 1,000 years where Jesus rules the earth from Jerusalem. Ruling the earth. Peace over the earth. Imagine during that time, the scripture says a lamb will lay down by a lion. You don't have to worry about a puff adder or a green mamba. When it bites you, it's not going to affect you. Why? Because Jesus is ruling the earth for 1,000 years. I know the Jehovah's Witnesses talk a lot about the 1,000 years reign. We say yes, it's going to happen. But it's part of God's plan. Amen. So, 1,000 years on the earth of peace. And during that time, before that time, we as Christians, we will be presented with our rewards of what we do by Jesus Christ himself. But after that will be the white throne judgment recorded for us in the book of Revelation. For the next few weeks, I want you to read the book of Revelation. Don't be afraid. You don't have to be scared. We'll go through the book of Revelation here, and you will see how God's hand moves over this nation. Are you here?
Amen.
The white throne judgment is for every person that was ever born that did not receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. They'll be judged on their lives. God is a just God. They will be judged according to how they live this life. That's the white throne judgment. Are you here?
Amen.
And after that, we go into something new. It's called the new heaven and the new earth. God recreates. He makes something new out of this mess that man messed up. This planet that man has destroyed. And Jesus will be there, and there's a new heaven and there's a new earth. Everything changes. That basically is the way things are going to go, in a nutshell. We started off in eternity in the past, and we finish with a new heaven and a new earth, and we go into eternity in the future. This, my friend, is not going to have any value in the future. Right now, it's very valuable. It tells me when you're falling asleep. But in the future, time will be no more. So people will not get old or older. They'll just stay just the way they are, because they'll be taken out of time. Thank you. Let's go to verse number 3. Sean, would you read verse number 3 to 7, please?
Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places."
Nice pictures there, Derek, reminding the people of the earthquakes and the wars and things that are coming. You see, the disciples asked Jesus 3 questions, and Jesus answers. Change to the other pictures. These are not so nice. People dying there. Where's the picture you had before this? That's war. When you see those things, you must know war is coming. And we're seeing more of that in the Middle East. Okay. The disciples asked Jesus 3 questions. Tell us, when will these things be? Say that with me. When will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming? Say that. And of the end of the age. So there's 3 questions they're asking Jesus there. And he answers those 3 questions in Matthew chapter 24. If you read the whole chapter, you'll see that Jesus answers their question. But you need to take the time to read, what is Jesus saying to his disciples? And what is Jesus saying to us? When you read prophecy, you must let other books of the Bible interact with the ones that you're reading to get a clearer picture of what's happened. You see some things recorded in the book of Revelation, you say, well, how can this be? Here, Jesus gives us exactly what's happening. He tells us that there will be a lot of deception. Last week, Quentin mentioned that deception is coming. That's the first sign of the end times, when churches and nations get deceived. Deceived is, deception is simply thinking that you are right when you are wrong. How do you know who's right or who's wrong? You simply judge it by the foundation. And what's the foundation? The word of God. So you judge everything by the word of God. If I stand up here and say the sun will come up in the west tomorrow, you must make sure you run out of the door. Because the Bible never said that. Amen. We must understand that everything that we say and do must be judged by the word of God. Always put it there and say, Lord, what are you saying to us? Number one, end times deception. Many will come in my name. He says, you hear wars and rumors of wars. Right now, we're hearing of rumors of wars coming. Nation rising up against nation. Famines. Earthquakes. These are the beginnings of sorrow. Beginnings of sorrow. You see, what's happening around us will cause us to take note. You don't have to go very far. Just drive on South African roads. There's one law for all the people, and there's another law for taxis. I'm serious. Serious. They are law unto themselves. Nobody's going to challenge them. Even the government is scared of them. That's the truth. We must call a spade a spade. They can turn in front of you, do whatever. Don't argue with them, because they'll shoot you. Leave them. Let them go their own way. I'm serious. Wake up. Lawlessness abounds in even in our country. It's the time of the end times. Okay? You're all going to pay toll. They're not going to pay toll. Why? Because they're going to tell the government, you're not going to make us pay toll. How's that? Which country are you living in? I thought we were in the same place. I saw a video clip the other day. Somebody sent me a video clip of somebody in Johannesburg that was jaywalking. And he happened to bump into the taxi. You saw that? Terrible. The taxi, for those that didn't see it, the taxi driver reversed. This guy was on the pavement. He went under the pavement and knocked him over. And he reversed and parked on the side of the road. Taxi driver, Jobo, parked on the side of the road. Somebody asked him something. You know what he did? He got up and he came and kicked the guy on the face. Lawlessness will abound. That's what's happening. Even in our country, not far, far away, here it's happening. We've got to speak up for the truth and make sure that people know that, hey, this is the end times that we're living in. Amen. A lot of false prophets all around us in the nation. Lawlessness, false prophets. We need to pray for our reverend here and for all those that are involved in justice, because they're trying their best to bring justice in the country. We need to pray for those that are involved, even our minister of justice. We need to pray for people that are in the country trying. But I'm just highlighting what's happening. Just one phase of what's happening. Are you here? This is the end times. Don't be surprised. Because it's not only here, it's in other countries as well. Some countries, it's worse than the others. So, NATO got rid of the dictator, Gaddafi. They took him out. And now what's happened? Part of the country is breaking up, and they want autonomy, and they're fighting amongst themselves. And NATO won't do anything, because while they were fighting and getting ready to take out Gaddafi, they were sending their the oil barons and tycoons into the country to sign deals with Libya to make sure that they got the oil. Britain and France. And you think, wow, they're doing a great thing, they're taking out the dictator. Well, actually, they're making sure that they got oil for their country. Wake up! We're living in the end times. This is the end times. Understand that we are here and we have a mission. And our mission is the gospel. Sometimes I'm amazed that Christians, that we get so caught up with what's happening all around us, we forget the important things. Now, I gave you homework. Go and read the book of Revelation. Can you also read Matthew chapter 24, please? I said please. So that when you come back here and we're talking about these things, we're on the same page. I can go on and on and on, but I need to bring this to a close today. I just want to just touch on briefly what Jesus is saying in Matthew chapter 24 from verse number 15 to 28. He's talking about the great tribulation. Say great tribulation.
Great tribulation.
I just want to read verse 15 to you. Why I started with talking to you about Jerusalem. He says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads it, let him understand. So what happens here, according to the book of Daniel, is in the midst of the tribulation time. Remember that 7 years that I was telling you about. Antichrist takes an image of himself and he puts it in the temple. Now, one thing a Jew will never do is pray to an image. Christians will pray to images. Go to any Catholic church, you'll see that. Sorry, but that's the truth. But a Jew will never bow down to an image. And so Antichrist puts his image in the temple. And that's what Daniel calls the abomination of desolation, standing in the holy place. That's the time he's saying to the Jews, run for your life. Because Antichrist is going to destroy you. So Jesus talks about the time of the great tribulation. Remember, he's answering three questions that his disciples asked him. When will these things be? He's answering those questions. And then he goes on to, after the tribulation, from verse 29 to 31, it talks about the second coming of Jesus. The people who say to you, Jesus is in India, Jesus is in South America, just laugh at them. Okay, because he says here, as lightning flashes from the east to the west, the whole world will know about it. Are you here?
Amen.
Don't fall for people's tricks. This guru calls himself Jesus Christ, and he can show you some marks. Thank you very much. I know when Jesus comes back, I'll recognize him. Okay. Then you go to verse 32 to verse 35. It's called the parable of the fig tree. Remember, Jesus did a strange thing when he was with the disciples. He went up to the fig tree and he's looking for fruit. And because he found no fruit, he cursed the fig tree. You know, when Jesus looks at your life, you must see some fruit. Are you a fruitful Christian? Are you a Christian that's bearing spiritual fruit as well? He wants to see some things in your life. Jesus cursed that tree and that tree died. The next day, Peter looked at the tree and said, Lord, the tree you cursed is dead from the roots. And Jesus said, have faith in God. Or have the God kind of faith. But whenever the fig tree is mentioned in the Bible, it talks about the nation of Israel. Don't forget that. And he said, when you see this fig tree blossoming, know that the end is at hand. From 1948 till now, every week, people are going back to Jerusalem. Every week, they're going back to Jerusalem to establish a nation there, in the midst of hostility all around them. You don't understand what's happening, but it's a spiritual thing. Because Jesus said so, it will happen. He says, when you see the fig tree blossoming, he said something interesting here. He says, surely I say to you, this generation will by no means pass away till all these things take place. Wow, that's scary. That's scary. He says, you will see what I said will happen. That's what Jesus is saying to the people. And then he goes on to say, no one knows the day or the hour from verse 36 to 42. But he wants us to always be ready. Be ready. He says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be. Isn't it like the days of Noah? Tell the people, hey, Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. They look at you like, where did you come from? But Noah was building the ark all the time, preaching to the people. They didn't want to listen to him. When they listened to him, when they realized that he was speaking the truth, it was too late. That's how the rapture happens. When suddenly millions of people are gone, then you're going to wake up and say, well, why didn't I listen and give my heart to the Lord? Why didn't I serve the Lord while it was easy? But I'm sorry, after the rapture, the time of grace is over. If you want to be saved, you got to give your life. Amen. For what you believe. If not, you take the mark of the beast. And if you take the mark of the beast, you'll never be part of God's kingdom. You can never be in heaven and part of the children of God if you take that mark that's coming up during the tribulation. But everything is being set into place. On everything you buy, every item in the store has got a barcode. Have you seen that? Amen. Look at that barcode very carefully. It starts with a 6. The center has got a 6. And the end has got a 6. I'm not telling you don't buy anything from the supermarket. I'm saying to you, wake up and know that it's setting up for the end time. It's setting up for the end time. Okay? So you'll have a barcode, then you'll have to go through the scanner. Now that's for the tribulation. And I pray that none of you will be there. But according to this scripture, 2 will be in the field, 1 will be taken. The other one will be left behind. 2 will be grinding at a mill. 1 will be taken, the other will be left behind. What did it show you? 50% of the church world, half the church will be left on the earth. That's scary. Half the church goes through the tribulation. And a lot of them give their life to Jesus. Because suddenly it dawns on them that they missed the boat. And how can I say a lot of them will get saved? Because you read the book of Revelation and you see they're crying out to God and say, Lord, you need to sort these people out. Because they died and they went to heaven. And the Lord says, just wait a little. Just wait a little. So, now you can willingly serve God. Don't wait till it's too late. Don't wait for the future and say, one day I'll sort my life out. Listen, you can't sort your life out. Just give your heart to Jesus. He'll sort you out. Amen. That's all. Listen, one day when I'm perfect, I'll come to church and I'll serve the Lord. No, if you're waiting to get perfect, then you're in the wrong church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on now. It's about your heart and serving Jesus.
Amen.
You don't need to wait to the end there. Rather now, while you see all these things happening, don't miss out. Where did you get this revelation thing from, Pastor? Where did you get this rapture thing from? 1 Thessalonians. Let's read this quickly. I want to close now. 1 Thessalonians. Quickly. Chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And I'm reading verse number 13. Let's read from verse 13 to 18, Michonne, please.
But I do not want to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, Even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we were alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first.
And verse 17, 18.
Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
So this is now a description of the rapture, of what will take place. The word caught up is where we get the word rapture from. So the believers will be caught up, but the Christians that died already, they will be resurrected at the rapture. The believers that died, their spirits will unite with their bodies and they'll be raptured at that time. That's why I believe firmly, maybe I'm old-fashioned, but I believe that Christian believers should be buried when they die and not cremated, because cremation is the Hindu philosophy. It's not from the Bible. Jews do not cremate. Muslims do not cremate. Christians should not cremate, because we believe in the resurrection. If people don't believe anything, go ahead, they can do what they want to. I'm telling you as your pastor, that if you put there in your will, when you die, you want to be cremated, I'll do your service in church, but I'm not going to the crematorium. Straight. You know where I stand? Because I believe in the resurrection. Call me old-fashioned, you call me whatever you want to. Doesn't matter. I believe what God said in His Word will happen. If God said it, that's what's going to happen. Amen. So Christians are going to be resurrected at the rapture. The dead in Christ will rise again, because God always favors the Baptist. Just a joke. God wants all of us to be with Him. Amen. And so we that are alive will be caught up with the Lord. You see, at that point, Jesus does not put his foot on the earth. He does not touch the earth. He's in the clouds. The trumpet sounds. Only the true believers will hear that, because the Holy Spirit will take them out. The rest of them will go on and they'll try and find an explanation of why so many people disappear. Is this in your Bible? You better believe it. It's in your Bible. Remember, this is part of the gospel. I've got to teach you the whole gospel. In January, I taught you about finance. In February, we looked at the eagle. And now, in March, we're looking at the end times. Got to give you different things to think about, because you've got to be a balanced Christian. Amen. The local pastor is like a GP. You got to make sure that we take care of everything a little bit. Amen. Are you glad you came to church?
Amen.
Don't be afraid of the future. Don't be afraid of tomorrow. Jesus has everything in His hand. Whatever unfolds on the earth, whoever's controlling Iran, whoever's controlling Saudi Arabia, whoever's controlling Africa or South Africa, don't be concerned about it. These things are going to happen. You just be wise and know what's coming, and redeem the time with your faith. Tell people that Jesus is coming back again. Tell them that there's going to be a tribulation on the earth. Tell them that what's happening today is nothing compared to what's going to come. And tell them that they ever find themselves in a position where you are not around, don't ever receive that dreaded mark of the beast. The people that receive that will never be part of God's kingdom. Remember that. That's your responsibility. Go and preach the gospel. Tell them the whole truth, and not just what they want to hear. Jesus is coming back again.
Amen.
Let's stand. Give him prayer. Father, I thank you for every person here today. Thank you for your right hand over their lives, Father. You called them out of this world. You brought them here today by your Holy Spirit. And Father, I thank you that your word is a seed that is set in their hearts and it will grow and bear fruit. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke every demon from hell that tries to steal God's word from his children. I declare that they will become strong believers and they will stand strong in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your grace upon your children. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Say this after me. Lord Jesus,
I
thank you
for your word.
I believe
that
you came to this earth.
You
died for my sins.
I believe
that right now
you are at the right
hand
of the Father
in heaven.
Lord Jesus,
I believe
that you're coming back to this earth.
And I thank you, Lord,
for saving me,
for making me part
of your kingdom.
Thank you, Lord Jesus,
for writing my name
in the book of life
in heaven.
I thank you
for your grace
upon my life.
Help me, Lord,
to preach the gospel
wherever I can.
Help me, Lord,
to be a testimony
of your grace
and your goodness.
Thank you, Lord,
for speaking to me today.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
And now as you go out, may the grace of God be settled in your heart
and in your life.
May you experience the presence of the Holy Spirit
wherever you go.
May you delight in what God does through the ministry of his holy angels over your life.
May you see
and rejoice in the grace of God today and in the days to come.
Go in the power of the Holy Spirit.